Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Grace Lutheran Church. It is a wonderful occasion that God, on this crisp, bright, sunny Sunday morning, he's brought us all together in this place, his house, to serve us as his children. A handful of announcements this morning. First of all, we have begun a new season here at Grace. That's the purple color you see around. So we've started the season of Lent. Lent being a Latin word for spring. Something is sprouting forth in the world and in our lives through Lent. And what the changing of the season usually means here at Grace is we change our order of worship in the bulletin. So I'm going to warn you all, especially those of you that have some of the other one memorized by now, that this is a different one, and anything you have memorized is different now. And so don't rely on your memory, but watch closely for a couple of weeks. And what we have is kind of an adaptation of the old 1941 Lutheran Forever Eternal service. And so if you grew up a Lutheran from about 1941 to 1980-something, there was only one hymnal, and this was the only service that had communion in it. And so it should sound, look pretty familiar to you no matter what, if you count yourself among those that grew up Lutheran and remember that time. But for everybody, remember, watch it, or you'll get tripped up a little bit. Let's see, what do I want to do? Oh, we have now started with Ash Wednesday as we step into Lent, a series of midweek services on Wednesdays. These are at 11:15, 7:15. And we are, through this season, going to be looking at some of the different Gentile figures around Jesus close to his time of passion and how they made an impact and how they made a unique impact because of their worldview that was different from some of the disciples and so forth. And so that's going to be what we're looking at. We'd love it if you could join us. There's a schedule for that and our Holy Week worship in the bulletin insert. What else? Oh, Adult Sunday School. This is the last week of our current rotation of things. Starting next week and for a month, you're going to have 4 weeks of what I'm going to call something like Pastor Martin's favorite things. So each week, an unconnected study, we're just going to look at my favorite things to talk about, some of my favorite Bible stories, some of my favorite parts of the catechism, that kind of a thing. And so you're welcome to join for one or more of those. Again, they're not connected, so you can just jump in and out as your schedule allows. And that begins next week. Let's see. Oh, with the addition of the new music director, we are still looking for people to join the adult choir. If that's something you're interested in, there's a sign-up sheet right outside the office. If you're interested in music in a different capacity, children's choir, hand chimes, an instrument, a solo, anything like that, her information is on the bulletin insert as well, or you can talk to me and I can point you in the right direction for that. With a new month and week, we have some new catechism remembrances. If you could pull out your bulletin insert for a second. First of all, we have a new verse of the month selected by our Board of Education to kind of keep one verse of the Bible on our hearts and minds and commit to memory. And so if you would be so kind as to, under that Board of Education verse of the month heading there on about the second page of the bulletin insert, just simply read that verse with me now. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Now also, we've been doing different sections of the catechism every week, so if you would recite the seventh commandment with me now. You should not steal. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so that we do not take our neighbor's money or possessions or get them in any dishonest way, but help him to improve. And the eighth commandment, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so that we do not tell lies about our neighbor, betray him, slander him, or hurt his reputation, but defend him, speak well of him, and explain everything in the kindest way. I'll quickly just mention that also we've been having a hymn of the month. So the first communion hymn is that hymn of the month that we'll see each Sunday throughout March as our first communion hymn to just kind of get used to, in this case, a Lenten hymn. Let's see. Are there any other announcements that I've missed that anyone wants to highlight? Okay. Then with that, I'll just quickly explain. As we step into this new season of Lent, what we're going to be looking at for the next several weeks is to kind of prepare our hearts and minds for the joy of Easter to come. And the way we do that is we see the sacrifices and the sufferings of Jesus that he endured for us, kind of culminating on Good Friday and then leading into that Easter joy. And so today we're going to be looking at specifically what amounts to temptation. And that the best account for that is his 40 days in the wilderness being tempted by the devil. And so we'll look at that as our theme in our gospel lesson and throughout our service today. And we'll look at how pride and temptation affect our own lives and what Jesus' temptation means for us when we're in some of those situations. So that is our theme today as we step into this new, slightly more somber season of the church year. And with that, it's very fitting that we have the opening hymn that we have before us, and I invite you to stand as we join together in singing. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, imploring him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Please kneel or be seated for a time of confession. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner,
confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. For I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and pray you of your God's mercy, for the sake of all the innocent, bitter sufferings and death.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you of all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand to share the peace and joy of that forgiveness with one another. Peace the Lord. We have a song. No, I do. Yeah, because it's in a goofy spot. You were not going to shake my hand. You are a hiding place for me. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. I acknowledged my sin to you. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Therefore, let everyone who is godly, surely in the rush of great waters, you are a hiding place for me. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord God, you led your ancient people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land. Guide the people of your church that following our Savior, we may walk through the wilderness of this world toward the glory of the world to come. through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from Genesis, the third chapter. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God actually say, 'You shall not eat of any tree in the garden?'" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die.' But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not surely die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, 'Where are you?' And he said, 'I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself.' He said, 'Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree which I commanded you not to eat?' The man said, 'The woman who you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit of the tree, and I ate.' Then the Lord God said to the woman, 'What is this that you have done?' The woman said, 'The serpent deceived me, and I ate.' The Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and the dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel.' To the woman he said, 'I will surely multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you.' And to Adam he said, 'Because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return.' The man called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. And the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skins and clothed them." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Paul's letter to the church at Rome, in the fifth chapter. "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. For sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was the type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have grace of God and the free gift by grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the result of that one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brought justification. If because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 4th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to them, or said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Begone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Please be seated. I now invite the children to come forward for the children's message. Okay, while we're figuring things out, I know I forgot the creed. I get it. I know. You can relax. I promise I'll put it back in. We'll get there. All right, guys. Good morning. Okay, that was pretty good. Who knows how to play Simon Says? Anyone ever play Simon Says? Do you know? Does everybody know? Do you know how to play Simon Says? You know? You want to tell us about it?
You have to tell someone what to do.
Okay.
You have to say Simon Says an action, and everyone has to do that action.
Okay.
And you have to do what people say.
Okay. All right. So should we try it?
Yeah.
Simon Says, put your arm up. Simon Says, put your arm down. Simon Says, stand up. Okay, you can sit down. Oh, I got all of you. Okay, yeah, that's fair. Now, today we're talking a little bit about who we should listen to and who we should not listen to. Who are good people to listen to in our lives? Who are the right people to listen to?
God.
Very good.
The angels.
The angels? Okay.
Our parents,
there we go.
Jesus.
That's nice, yes.
A mom.
Yep.
Dad.
Yes. Anyone else? Are there any other good people to listen to?
You need to listen to your parents.
Yes, sir. At least we all got that down. That's good. Anyone else? Yeah?
I forgot.
How about teachers? Yeah. How about police officers?
Yeah.
How about firemen?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, now, what are some bad people to listen to? Who's a bad person to listen to?
Strangers.
That's a good one.
The devil.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. The devil.
Okay. You want to add something?
Devil.
There you go. Who's a bad person to listen to?
Someone who you don't know, and they're trying to actually make you die.
Yeah. Yes, that would be a bad person to listen to. You're right on.
So dove.
Okay. All right. So the people that are good to listen to, what are the kinds of things that they care about that they would tell us to do?
You run away from the big bad people.
To get away from the bad people? That's what the good people want? Yeah, you're right.
If they're trying to, someone says, hey, I have this cool app on my phone, he's trying to take you away.
Yes. Yeah, that's a very good 21st century lesson for all of us. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Weapons.
Yeah, don't listen to people with weapons. Now, today, in our lesson, Jesus is being told to do all kinds of things by the devil. What does he do? Do you think he does it? The devil's being very tricky.
You need to stab him, the bad guys, with a knife.
Okay, well, Jesus doesn't stab the devil with a knife. That's not part of the lesson.
A sword.
A sword. There's no stabbing at all in this lesson. Do you think Jesus fell for it, Lachlan?
Yes.
Oh, I'm failing you all today. Did Jesus fall for it?
No.
Thank you. Jesus does not fall for it. So, in our lives, sometimes it's really tricky when we see something that looks like a good thing to do, but maybe it's really bad. It's hard sometimes to know what's right and what's wrong. But Jesus is promising us that every step of the way, he's with us and he's giving us the strength to do the right things. Sound good?
Yeah.
Let's pray about it. Dear Jesus,
thank you
for being tempted by the devil and winning. So that I always know you fill me with the strength to do the right things. But when I mess up, thank you for forgiving me always. In your name. Amen. Okay, now let's set things right. Lori, can I have a second to get that creed in there? All right. All right, let's do this. Can everyone please stand? Let's confess together our faith in the triune God with the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us made and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit.
Please be seated for the hymn of the day.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be multiplied unto you from God our Father and the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for this morning's message is Jesus being tempted in the wilderness from Matthew chapter 4, so far the text. So there's a man. He's on the deck of a pretty large ship. And he goes to the edge, and there's a sign, of course, that says, no leaning over the edge, but what does the sign know? So he starts looking over, and the water's remarkably clear. He's pretty sure he could start to identify some things, and if he could see enough things, he might get a good story. He'd be able to tell some of the other passengers, and he'd look pretty neat. So he keeps looking, and he keeps looking, and eventually he loses his balance and goes over. So the man's in the water, he's struggling, he's going crazy, but luckily some of the other passengers on the ship see him down there struggling. They're able to alert someone on the crew to grab one of those circular buoys and toss it out there, and it was a pretty good toss. It got about 15, 20 feet away from the man, and despite his fatigue and shock from going overboard and trying to stay afloat despite the waves and the wind, he's able to swim over, grab onto the buoy. He's pulled up by the crew. He's placed back onto the deck. He's safe. The ordeal's over. And he looks up and sees everyone around. And he says something to the effect of, I mean, that toss was okay, but you see how strong a swimmer I was back there? You see how big those waves were? That was no match for me. I'm a really great swimmer. Did you see that? And when I grabbed that buoy, has anyone grabbed a buoy so tight before? I'm like the miracle rescued person to be able to do that. I've been really working on my arms lately. Do you see the definition in there when I was grabbing on tight? I don't know that anyone would have looked that good getting rescued. You saw that, right? You all saw that. Today we're talking about temptation and we're talking about pride. In our text, Jesus has the Holy Spirit go out ahead of him into the wilderness. And this is a rough wilderness. This is jagged, broken limestone all over the ground, crunching underneath your feet. This is up to 1,000, 1,200 foot drop-offs in different places. This is extreme heat during the day. This is extreme cold at night. Almost nothing can live out there. There's nothing to eat around. This is wilderness like no other. Now, what's really significant about this account is part of Jesus' sacrifice for all of us was for him to live in human form throughout this life and experience all the suffering that we do. So he got the flu and muscle aches, and he got sad, and he got mad, and he got tempted. And that's what this is about. And so we have this grand scale of him being tempted. Now, the devil knew Jesus for a very long time, or knew of Jesus for a very long, long time. But never did he have an opportunity like this, where Jesus is out in the roughest of wilderness, and Jesus is at the weakest point he would be throughout his life up to this spot. So it's been 40 days that Jesus has been out there. He's been fasting. He's hungry. I looked this up. A human being can live about 45 days without food. So Jesus is at the edge. Jesus has a lot of internal pain from his organs not being fed. He probably is starting to get a little bit confused. He's definitely not walking around anymore on those jagged rocks. And so the devil sees an opportunity. If he can tempt him, if he can get him to slip up, he wins. Jesus' whole ministry, his whole sacrificial life, all the promises made to God's people for thousands of years would all come crashing to a halt. And so he finds Jesus at the weakest of moments, and he goes in. That sounds familiar, right? You see, the devil doesn't come tempt us when we're at our best and strongest and feeling really good and headed off to church. No, that's not when the devil tempts us. The devil tempts us when we're in high school, sitting at the desk, staring onto a test, in a cold sweat because you studied the wrong thing or you didn't study enough the night before, right? you were tired, you were hungry, you were distracted, whatever it was, you didn't study enough, you didn't study the right things, and here you are in a panic at your desk, staring at this test, and for whatever reason, the person sitting right there is taking their test like this. Now, you don't know if they're very good at this particular subject, of course, but you do know they're not staring at the test with a cold sweat and a panic. That's a good start. And so right there you are, in weakness, and there's an opportunity right there. Or maybe the alarm clock went off just to get ready for work, and for some reason you just couldn't sleep well last night. You just couldn't. And, you know, last week, because of the lane closures, you got in kind of late. Nobody noticed that. No one talked to you about that. That was no big deal. You could really use a little bit extra. Why not just take another half hour? Go in late. No one saw it before. Why would they see it this time? Who's it going to hurt? The temptations come when we're at our weakest. So there's this other business about sometimes it's almost like it'd be easier to go for the temptation than not. Something like a kid, every week, at least one day, a bully comes up to get his lunch money. Shows him how tough he is, gets the lunch money. It's usually about $5. So the kid thinks, I'm not putting up with this anymore. I'm going to go take Taekwondo. Well, then he finds out that costs more than lunch does, and it's a lot of work. It's probably better to just pay the bully and be done with it. It's just easier. Sometimes when the thoughts in our mind are things like, who's going to find out? Well, they dared me. I really need this. It's going to be fine. When those are our thoughts, sometimes it's easier just to go with it. Sometimes the wrong thing looks like the easy thing, looks like the best thing, looks like the fast track to feeling terrific. Well, when Jesus is tempted, the devil first offers him bread. Well, no, he doesn't actually. The devil actually points out that he has the power to turn the rocks around him into bread and eat. And he just says, well, why don't you do that? And then the devil tells him, oh, look at all the great kingdoms of the world. I'll give up. You won't have to suffer anymore. This 40 days in the wilderness, that can be it. If you just bow down and worship me, that one little thing, I'll give you everything else. I'll give up. The devil takes him to a really high point of the temple with something like a 1,000-foot drop over the edge and says, well, throw yourself down. Wouldn't it be neat? As bad as you feel right now, to feel the relief if the angels picked you up and cared for you. There's a funny thing about each of those temptations. Each of those temptations were not things that the devil had to give. Those are not things in the devil's power to give to Jesus. You know what the devil is offering Jesus? The devil's offering Jesus the same thing that he offered to Adam and Eve. When he said, did God really say? When he said, you can be like God if you just eat the fruit. The devil is once again tapping into his best trick. He's offering pride. He's offering your ego a nice feeling. See, every sin can find its foundation, its roots in pride. And if Jesus was fully human, that would have been a tug. And the temptation here is, he's known the devil for a long time. Defeating the devil was always the goal. He can show the devil who's boss. Show his power. Turn some stones into bread. Jump down and have the angels show up and care for him. He can flex his godlike muscle and leave the pain and suffering of being a human behind for just a little bit. The devil is tapping in to pride. Now, it's an interesting thing, really, this story. Because the people that are there, or the characters that are there. We got Jesus, we got the devil, some angels show up, the Holy Spirit's there. Who told the story to get into Matthew, Mark, and Luke, all three of these Gospels? Jesus did. He had to. Jesus told the disciples this story. Now, if we were to think about any other human being in history and why they would tell a story like this of standing up to the devil at your weakest point and winning, we would think it was all about pride. But it's not. There's a couple of other interesting details going on here that completely turns that expected conclusion on its head. First of all, in all three Gospels, this exact account comes right after Jesus' baptism. And the Holy Spirit goes on ahead of Jesus into the temptation. And so, Jesus is not giving us this account to show us what he did. Jesus is giving us this account to show us what's been done for us, to show us what we're capable of. Because in the same way, once we're baptized, once the Holy Spirit comes upon us and lives inside of us, just as Jesus sent his Spirit out into all of us, now we've got some strength there. Now we can have some confidence because with God on our side, with God empowering us, with God all around us, we can do the same thing. We can stand up to temptations of pride. We can stand up to temptations at our weakest. We can do these things because the Spirit of God is living inside of us and going on before us the same way. Jesus gives us this account as an example to show us of a victory that he won for us. You know, another amazing thing, the second really amazing detail here is when it ends, Jesus simply tells the devil to go away, and you know what he does? He goes away. Why? Because God is bigger and stronger, infinitely so, than the devil ever has been or will be. God has no equal, God has no opposite. There is a battle that's been going on. But as we sit here this morning, that battle has been won for you, and you are on the side of the victor. The one who stood up to the devil has sent his Spirit into you to give you strength and hope and comfort and confidence every single day. So now, we look at this account and what we see is, well, Jesus fasted in the wilderness, not to show you, but for you. Jesus stood up to the devil for you. Jesus defeated the devil for you. Jesus sent his Spirit into you in your baptism for you. Jesus forgives you every time you mess up. Jesus reminds you that your relationship with him, having the Spirit inside of you, is something that is never going to end, is something that can stand up to the greatest tests of pride, of comfort, of ego that could ever come along. And this example tells us all that is possible. And so as we step forward into Lent, this sprouting of something new season, we see Jesus suffering in this very most human of ways, and we see yet another gift that he's given to us. And we see that we are never alone, and we are never too small or too weak. We are always big enough and strong enough to take on this day, this season, our whole lives, because he did it first, and he did it for you. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which certainly surpasses understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ to life eternal. Amen. Please stand for prayer. This morning we pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and all people according to their needs. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. For this nation, for our cities and communities, our leaders and the military who protect us, including and especially remembering Renee, Jesse, Abby, Michael, Derek, Dan, James, Michael, Stephen, Tim, Jonathan, Paul, Chandler, Stephen, Randall, Chris, Sean, Stephen, Evan, Laith, Paul, and Nathan. And for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. For the sick and for those who care for them, including and especially remembering Vic, Bonnie, Rose, Trish, Jerry, Mary, Tish, Eli, Joe, Louise, Susan, Elfrida, Norma, Loxley, Jimmy, George, Linda, Rosemary, Gail, Dawn, Rick, Eris, Janice, Donnie, Johnny, Joanne, Josephine, John, Lori, and Cassie. Let us pray to the Lord. For the birth and the adoption of Serenity Grace, we rejoice with the Potter family. Let us pray to the Lord. For all of us as we journey through this Lenten season, that our eyes would be fixed on Jesus every step of the way. Let us pray to the Lord. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is good and right.
It is truly good, right, and necessary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with the angels and the archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we lord and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive and renew and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the end of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, and deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory and honor, worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please stand. The body and the blood of Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in true faith to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endures forever.
Let us pray. O God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.